Come on, people of God, let's lift our hands all over this place and let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Hallelujah. Let's lift our hands and worship Him. Let's give Him glory this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, let's give Him glory this morning. Last week was a horrible week for the world, wasn't it? Ah, my God. Killings and shootings and all manner of evil. The heart of men have become desperately wicked. Oh, but this morning there is a God in Zion. Oh, hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord this morning for God. Oh, we don't have to worry or fret. Oh, the Lord of Jacob, Abraham and Isaac, the God of gods is here. The King of kings is here. And we have an anchor that keeps the soul. Hallelujah. We're troubled on every hand, but God is our refuge and strength, a present help in the time of trouble. Let the people of God arise and shout and give glory to your God this morning. In spite of everything that is happening around us, God is God, and He always will be God. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's shout a praise today. Let's shout the highest praise this morning. Let's rock this place with our worship this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. As we sing, we just want you all to open your mouths and just begin to give God the glory this morning. Because in spite of everything, we serve a God that we can trust. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
With all thy heart.
With all of thy heart. And lean not to thine own understanding.
But in all thy ways.
But in all thy ways.
Acknowledge Him.
Acknowledge Him. And He shall direct thy path.
Let's sing it like we mean it this morning. Trust in the Lord.
Trust.
With all thy heart,
with all of thy heart,
oh God,
and lean not to thine own understanding,
but in all thy ways,
but in all thy ways,
acknowledge
Him,
and He shall
direct thy path.
Let's sing the chorus one more time. Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord. With all of thy heart.
Lean not
to thine own understanding.
But in all thy ways.
But in all thy ways.
Acknowledge Him.
And He shall direct.
One more time, trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
Oh God,
with all thy heart, and lean not to thine own understanding, but in all thy ways, acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy path.
We're going to sing verse 1. Are you searching for solution?
Are you searching for solution?
And the answers
so hard to find.
Are the pressures of life.
Are the pressures of life getting you down.
Why don't you cast your cares? Why don't you cast
your cares on him?
For I know.
For I know he cares.
Is there anything too hard?
Is there anything too hard for him?
Oh, that he cannot do.
Trust in the
Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord, trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all thy heart.
And lean
not to thy own
understanding.
Understanding in all thy ways.
Lord, thy ways.
Won't you? Trust him this morning. Oh, hallelujah. And if it had not been for the
Lord on my side,
if it had not been
for the Lord.
I'll never forget what you've done for me.
Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out.
Jesus, I'll never forget.
Ah!
Yeah.
Hallelujah. 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 Walk around and greet several persons. Greet them warmly in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Sister Beverly McHugh is coming to give us our official welcome and to tell us what's on the agenda here at Pentecostal Tabernacle.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. I tell you, the heat is on. Praise God. It's a wonderful time to be here at Pentecostal Tabernacle. In fact, you don't want to be anywhere else. Amen? Praise God. Can we just shout hallelujah? Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I'm just so excited about Jesus. I'm excited because I'm back with my family here. I love you all. The smiles are beautiful. I'm seeing some lovely smiles. Wow. I wonder if the smiles are behind here too. They just put it on. All right. Do we have any visitors with us this morning? You're here and you are celebrating with us. Praise God. I'm just going to ask you to stand. Can we just clap our hands? We are extremely happy that you are here, and we want to boast about it. Amen? Those persons who are close by, please extend a warm handshake, complemented by a smile. Praise God. Please, on behalf of all of us, we want to welcome you again to the service, and we trust that you will come again. You can also make this your home. Praise God. I'm also seeing Brother Cranston. I know I saw him somewhere. Welcome, sir. Oh, praise. Can you just shout hallelujah for us, sir? Amen. Praise God. I'm not sure what musical note that was, but it's coming from the belly. Those persons who are... Sir said C sharp. All right. Those persons who are also members here, but you were away and you're now back. Anybody here like that? You just want to wave your hand? Amen. Praise God. Welcome back. Hey, praise God. It was just not the same without you. Clap your hands for them too. And if you are viewing us live from all over the world, we are saying welcome to the service. Praise God. Turn to your neighbor and say, listen to the announcements. So this evening, I think at 6:30 p.m., we will have our street service at Balcom Drive. And this is off Olympic Way, praise God. And our pastor will tell us some more information about that service. On Tuesday, 12 to 2, our Golden Ages, they will be praying right here in the sanctuary. That's this Tuesday at 12 to 2 p.m. And I'm sure they are looking forward to that. On Tuesday at 6 p.m., Pentab Youth will be supporting Fellowship Apostolic Church. In fact, that church is having a youth conference, and it will be held at 16 Camp Road. You don't want to miss this Tuesday at 6 p.m. On Wednesday, 6:30 a.m. morning manna, 11:30 a.m. prayer and fasting service, and of course, our Bible study at 6:30 p.m., and we start that off with prayer. Prayer is at 6:30 and Bible study is at 7. On Thursday at 6 p.m., all the youth, they are being invited to choir practice. Remember, this Thursday at 6 p.m. That's youth choir practice. I'm sure the adult choir members are celebrating. On Saturday the 23rd, on a very sad note, but we want to be here. Let me see the hands of those who remember Sister Rita Thomas. We want to come out in our numbers this Saturday. Everybody say this Saturday. At 9 a.m., we will be having the homegoing service for Sister Rita Thomas. And it will be held right here at Pentecostal Tabernacle. The interment will be in Kensington, St. Anne, and a bus is available. Now, the cost is $1,000 and not $1,200. So there's a discount of $200. All right, per person, $1,000. So persons who are interested in transportation, you're being asked to contact Brother Michael Thompson or Sister Tanisha Hart by Sunday, July. Oh, well, today. So if you're interested, please go to Brother Thompson or Sister Tanisha Hart. For this upcoming Sunday at 6 a.m., we have Rightly Dividing the Word on RJR Fame FM, 7 a.m. prayer time in the sanctuary, 8 a.m. precession, and at 8:30 a.m. Sunday school, 10:15 a.m. worship service, children's church, and teen tab. Finally for teen tab. At 12 noon, the funeral service for the mother of Sister Sonia Gibbons will be held at Colonel Cove, Morant Bay, St. Thomas. Transportation is available for 30 persons at no cost. Again, you are being invited to contact Brother Michael Thompson today. And next week, Sunday, we'll be having our evening service, and it starts at 6:45 p.m. God bless you, everybody. Have a great week, and may the presence of God be with you always. Praise God.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Sister McHugh. Amen. Let's say God bless Sister McHugh. Amen. Praise the Lord, everyone. Now, brothers and sisters, at 5:45 this afternoon, we do need for all of us, as many of us as is possible, to come to that Balcom Drive area as we did 2 weeks ago and just walk the streets inviting persons to the meeting. We just have an open door and we don't know how long the door will be open. And so it's important for us to walk through the door and to do all we can. Amen? Amen? We don't want to let up. As we have said, during the last weeks of the school term at the school, over 40 of the students have received the Holy Ghost, and teachers and several parents have received the Holy Ghost, and we just, many have been also delivered. And so we don't want to relax, amen, because there's a long period before school reopens. Amen. And the devil is not going to take what happened He's not going to take it sitting down. So we have to be wise. Amen. Service will start at 6:30. And so we are looking forward to just having a great time. Praise the Lord, everyone. With regards to the Thanksgiving service for Sister Rita Jane Thomas, we're going to ask the combined choir to be prepared to minister during that service. Amen? Is that all right, choir members? 9 o'clock on Saturday. 9 o'clock on Saturday. Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. All right, let's all stand. Hold on, sit. I believe Brother Gary McKenzie's here, the eldest son of Brother George McKenzie. Gary, where are you? Put your head through the door and shout, praise the Lord. Amen. All right, let's stand. Ushers, would you come, please? Now we should be getting back thousands of pledge forms. Remember what we spoke about last week? Yes? And what about our first fruit offering? When is that supposed to happen? The end of the month. Yes, yes. And we are looking forward to a great harvest, not of souls. Well, souls, yes, but also a great harvest of your first fruits. Remember how we said the first fruits work? You remember? Yes, you remember? You want a reminder? First fruits is an Old Testament principle. So, what used to happen is that the first crop in the harvest season, that first crop, all of it belonged to the Lord. All of it belonged to the Lord. And then whatever occurred after that, you would give a tenth of that to the Lord, but the rest belonged to you. So most all of us have been living without that money that we're supposed to get back for many years. And we weren't banking on it. But when the party in power made that promise to us, we had plans for it. But the church is trying to intervene to say that first month, we wouldn't want a tithe of it. We would want all of it as a first fruits, and then in all the subsequent months, you would just give a tithe, right? You wouldn't take all of it, you know, you'd still give a tithe. Wouldn't that be right? Can you say amen? You understand now, brethren? So this July month, tell your neighbor, pastor wants it all. The Golden Age Choir, you are singing in that service on Saturday as well, but combined choir is ministering. Now, how many persons would want, if we provided a bus this evening, you would want to ride on it? Could you just wave your hands? Persons, please do it, brethren, until I tell you to stop. I just need to. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. All right. Let's all stand. I want to explain, brethren, that if you are here and you it's difficult for you to stand, or when you stand, it's difficult for you to keep standing for an extended period of time, please don't put yourself under pressure. We appreciate that. Different ones of us have different challenges, and so you don't have to feel bad. You can be seated, all right? We're talking about those who are able to stand. And I see some young persons, I don't know what is going to happen when you get old. You're born old. When I was young, I couldn't get tired. It was difficult to get tired. I didn't know what stress meant, you know. It's in my, almost in my 30s, I hear about stress. I didn't know about stress. Little children my age, I never hear a little child say, I'm stressed out. I never know about that. Is me used to stress out my parents? I never know about stress. But even 2-year-old know about stress now. What a world. Brethren, are you praying for the situations in France and so on? We must remember that there's nothing that says it can't happen in Jamaica. That says it can't happen in Jamaica. Would you bow your heads, please? Lord Jesus, everything that we have is a gift from you. Our lives, our health, we might not be in the best of health, but we are healthy enough to be here. Everything that we have is a gift from you. Nothing that we have is really ours. We are just the custodians occupying until we are removed. We will not be here forever. Help us to use our time wisely. Help us to use our talents wisely. Help us to use our treasure wisely. Help us to make investments. Lord, last week we spoke about operation development. Please keep it in the forefront of our minds so that we can accomplish what we need to for your honor and glory. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. You may be seated. The ushers are going to be standing here. We're marching. As we bring our offering, and our singers and musicians will be leading us in worship.
My sins were higher than the mountain, and the Lord sanctified
me. My sins were like a river, and the Lord sanctified me.
My sins were higher than the mountain. Jesus in the morning. Give me Jesus in the evening.
Every moment of the day.
Just give me Jesus.
Give me Jesus in the evening.
a statement that we really don't have to make, but sometimes it can even get into our hearts that we are God. Amen. We wouldn't say it, but we act as if we are God. But God is God. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. Amen. We are very happy to have our former music director, Brother Cranston Forbes, with us today. And Brother Cranston is working and ministering in the Cayman Islands. And he has recently released a CD. And so it is here with us. And we want Brother Cranston to come and to just share two of the songs from the CD. And the CDs will be available after the service. Now, that room there, the music room, you could go there and you could get a copy of the CD. Brother Cranston, what's the cost? $500. And we have another CD here, which was done by our former national superintendent, Bishop John Smith. Yes. And we have it here too, also for just $500. And we have another one here, which, yes, from Brother Kirby Trim, that we have been promoting. And Brother Trim came and did some of the songs. This one is for $1,000. And so we would like for you to come and to purchase all of them after. Just, oh my. I tell you something. When I was in the world, you know how they would promote a dance? If it was free, they would say, buy out the bar. Meaning to say, don't leave any drinks. So we would like you to buy out the CDs and not leave any. Amen. Let's just stand and worship the Lord. He's so good to us.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Just lift your hands, everybody, everywhere. Open up your mouths and begin to exalt Him. There is power in your sound. There is power in your worship. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Indeed, it's a privilege to be here because this is home. You may be seated. And I've spent all my life here. This is where I learned all that I know. I'm in the Cayman Islands, and we have seen God work. I remember my wife and I, we went to a church just ministering, which is a non-denominational church. And while ministering, the Spirit of God came down. The pastor called everybody to the altar and said that we all need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Unfortunately, there weren't enough people to pray with the folks. We have seen so many miracles. I was in Orlando, and while praying, I went to a church. Well, didn't want to go to the church. But while I was there, the Lord says, I need to go and come to Jamaica, so I'm here. I just want to worship the God with you. Simple song says, like the 2 in the morning.
Let your glory shine through me. at midnight. Let your glory shine through me. Overflow, overflow.
About you, but I'm very passionate. I remember sitting in an airport, waiting on a ride, missed my flight many times. And while I was there going to LA, I sat in a seat and two white persons came to me and they says, "Sir, you look like a Christian." I began to smile because before I left, the Lord told me that I would meet two persons and I didn't know who they were. And they said to me, "We're Haitists. We hate God." But God prepared me. So while I was there, I began to talk to them about God. They said, "Sir, my son just committed suicide last night, and he was an atheist." I said, "God is a God of the atheist." And right in the plane, they reached out and began to speak in another tongue. Because we know that our God is able. And so many times, we can be in church with a cloak on our face, we sing and we smile, but inside we're hurting deeply. But God is a God who is able. Oh God. So tonight, today, I believe in my heart that I'm here on assignment for one person who feel like giving up, who feel like letting go, but nobody knows, nobody see, really understand, because every time you come here, you smile and everybody see you, you feel happy, looking happy, but they don't know the hurt and the pain that you're going through. But we serve a God who's a God of a wounded heart. We serve a God who's a God who can mend broken hearts, because he is the broken heart mender. Hallelujah.
You lay your life down, you gave me your reason to turn my life around unto you, Lord. I praise as I sing. You turned my life round, you gave me your reason to live. More than I can say, you gave me your reason to live. Hallelujah. Praise Jehovah. Lord, I love you. You gave me your reason to. You see all I did, yet you extend your mercy toward me. Lord, I call your name unto you. I only brought shame. You made my life brand new, and a song in my heart, and it's you. More than I can say, you gave me a reason to live. Hallelujah. Praise Jehovah. Lord, I love you. You gave me. Save the earth.
nowhere to run. Lord, where would I be if it wasn't for your grace and your voice calling me? Nowhere to run. Lord, where would I be if it wasn't for your grace and your voice calling me?
Nowhere to run.
Lord,
Lord, where would I be
if it wasn't for your grace, oh God?
For your grace
and your voice.
And your voice.
Yeah, yeah, nowhere to run. In the shelter of your arms, in the safety of your home. One more time, I'm running back, oh, I'm running back to you,
Lord. In the shelter of your arms,
in the safety of your home. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Let's just stand, everybody. How many know that Jesus has given you a reason to live? That's more than a song for me. That's my prayer. Yes, how many? You know, I've run back to him many times. Many times. Let's lift our hands and worship. You gave me a reason to live. Yes, yes, yes. Didn't really have a purpose until I met Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. I want to encourage us, brethren, please go over to the music room and purchase a CD. I'm sure that you will be blessed. Well, you have heard it yourself. I know that most of us would have heard of that tragic event that took place at the tax office just a few days ago, that murder-suicide. It's very plain to see that something is wrong with our country. And there's no way that the church can absent ourselves from the situation. We need to take responsibility as well. I believe that there has been a failure in the whole church movement. We have been too much about our glory and building our own kingdoms and empires and hiding behind the walls of the church and not doing the work of the kingdom. Amen. Amen. We have been increasing ourselves and not investing in the kingdom. And so some of the blame has to be on the church. I'm not saying all or most. I'm just saying some. It's kind of unusual for a country to have more churches per square mile than any other country in the world and have almost more murders per square mile. Something seems to be wrong. So No, it was brought home to me. Sometimes it can seem so distant, you know, and you could get used to it. But a precious young lady just came to me during the offering, and she says, the daughter of the two parents come to school with me. So that's not far away. I wonder if we could just pray for that family. And Sister Jamila, would you just come out here? Sister Jeffrey, come with her. We need to pray for the class that girl attends. I don't know what I would do if I were a member of the class. Just crazy. And when we ask for us to be involved in the work of the Lord, there's a reason, eh? There's a reason. I'd like some of our ministers and some of our sisters, let's just come around these precious ladies. Let's just lift our hands and let's just talk to the Lord about that situation. Would you do that right now, please? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I think, brothers and sisters, that we probably need to try and do a little more. Maybe we need to try and see if we can work with this family of the young lady, and see if we can just be used of the Lord to bring some comfort to them. How many think that would be a good idea for? So we're going to try and do that. Amen. And brothers and sisters, there's nothing that says it can't happen in our family. There's just nothing that says it can't happen in our family. John chapter 11, verses 1 to 6. John chapter 11, verses 1 to 6. Just for a little while today, we want to examine this passage. John chapter 11, verses 1 to 6. Now a certain man was sick, named Lazarus, of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore, his sisters sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, He said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Lazarus loved Martha. Now Jesus loved Martha. Now Jesus loved Martha. So how is it that Lazarus is sick if he loves Martha and her sister Lazarus? When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was, for the glory of God. That's our subject, for the glory of God. You may be seated, please. It is apparent that there was a special bond that existed between our Lord and Lazarus when he, that is our Lord, lived out his life here on earth. There is nothing strange about that because Jesus lived his life on earth as a man. Amen? And human beings need friendship. And inasmuch as he was God, manifest in the flesh, he was a human being. And human beings relate to different people differently. So those of us who think that Jesus related to everybody the same way, we just need to get that out of our minds. See? According to the flesh, he had people that were in his inner circle and people that were not. That's just how it is. I'm not saying that's how he deals with us now, you know. I'm saying as a human being, that's how it was. So, and I often find myself wondering what the other 9 disciples felt every time that he was going on a special mission. He took just 3. I wonder if the other 9 were human beings too. And I wonder if as human beings they didn't say within themselves, why can't he take some of us? I wonder how all the others felt when he seemed to have a special relationship with John. John calls himself the disciple whom Jesus loved. He was able to lean on the breast of Jesus. John was able to do this. So there seems to have been a special bond that existed between Jesus and Lazarus. When he became ill, his sisters didn't even call a name. They wanted to evoke some amount of emotion in the breast of Jesus. They wanted to provoke him to action. So they said, the one that you love is sick. The one that you have a special relationship with is sick. And you know that they expected Jesus to jump right up and move immediately to Bethany and solve the problem, because the one that he loves is sick. Now, of course, they said the one whom you love is sick. And I don't want to split hairs here, but I think it's important that John uses 2 different words when he speaks of love. When he says to us that Martha and Mary sent word saying the one whom you love is sick, they use the word filio, which is a love called out of one's heart, because of a camaraderie, a special bond that exists, a sameness of thought, of ideas, of goals, of spirit. It is the love of friends, brotherly love, the love of persons who have things in common. And so because they had things in common, they said, they used that word, the one that you are fond of is sick. But in verse 5, where John gives us this little comment, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he says that in verse 5, he uses the word agape. So he's saying that it is apparent that the love that Jesus had for Lazarus and for his sisters was more than just a friendship. He loved them with a love called out of his heart because of their preciousness to him, regardless of whether they had anything in common with him or not. He loved them with a love that would cause him to make sacrifices for them. He loved them with a love that would keep on loving in spite of anything they did that was unlovable. So Jesus wasn't just fond of Lazarus. He didn't just like Lazarus because they were both laborites, or because they were both socialists, or because they both supported the same football team, or because they both went to Calabar, poor them. I'm sorry, Brother Kevin. He loved them because they were precious to him, and there was not necessarily anything in them that made them precious to him. So it didn't matter what they did, he would love them anyway. But we see here that persons whom Jesus loves get sick. People that he has this kind of love for do get sick. Even though he has this love for them, they get cancer. They have heart conditions. They have to be on a dialysis machine. People that Jesus loves with this kind of love sometimes lose loved ones. Sometimes persons that are precious to them are snatched away. Persons whom he loves. And the thought that pervades sometimes the church world is that they must have done something wrong. They must have offended God. So this is a punishment. I hear it so often. Most times things like these happen. The persons say, Pastor, what have I done wrong? Do you think I have done anything wrong? And I keep asking myself, why? What kind of theology would make them always think that? I am finding myself doing battle with the concepts that people have, struggling to appreciate that God loves them. Been in church all their lives, but not able to appropriate the fact that Jesus loves them, particularly when they go through difficult situations. Something is wrong. Mary and Martha believed with all their heart that just their word would have gotten Jesus up right away. He would come to their rescue. When Jesus heard of the situation. He said, this sickness is not unto death. But yet the man died. What Jesus was saying is that the purpose of the sickness is not to take Lazarus out. There is a greater purpose. Yes, he will die. But that's not the reason he's sick. He's sick so that I can get some glory. He's sick so that the Son of Man may be glorified thereby. This sickness really has nothing to do with Lazarus per se. I'm just going to use him to get glory for myself. And sometimes, to get glory for myself, I might have to take you out. Sometimes, to get glory for myself, you might have to get cancer. And you might die of cancer. You might not be healed. I may heal you so that I can astonish medical professionals. So that I can give you, let you see a new dimension of who I am. But I might allow you to go through it and die so that I can show people what a child of God is willing to go through for me and still retain their integrity. I might have to allow you to die in faith without receiving the promises, but still die being persuaded that I am a healer. How can I, when I am afflicted, before I begin to blame myself or blame God, before I begin to look for a reason in my own sinfulness, can I say, God, show me how you will get glory from this situation? This has come to give you glory. I am long past believing that every situation will work out for a child of God the way they think it should. I've come to tell you that your marriage might never be healed. I've come to tell you that it might end in divorce. That's not what I hope. But I am not in the stead of God, and I can give no guarantees. What I can say is that in every situation, Jesus is looking for some glory. And you don't have to, you can give God glory in your death. Your death can give him glory, not just your life. Could you turn to John chapter 21, please? I'll soon stop. Don't get nervous. Could you turn to John 21, verse 18? Jesus says this to Peter, verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. Verse 19, this spake he, signifying by what death he should. By what death he should glorify God. God expects that in your dying moment, your death will bring him glory. Because you weren't meant to live forever. I'm sorry. Take all the supplements you want and work out as much as you want. But let your death give him glory. It is about time for the apostolic movement to understand that you did not get saved so that Jesus could set you up. You got saved so that he could set himself up. You did not get saved so that Jesus could give you a platform to glory. You got saved so that you could become a platform for him to get glory from. You didn't get saved to wow the crowd. And so that people would idolize you. You got saved to give him glory. It's all about Jesus. And you and I are expendable. And so look for it to get rougher. Because God wants to get glory in this dark age. Before he comes for his people, he needs to get some glory from your life. And it's about time we get rid of this thinking that everything is about me and everything must cater to me and it must work out the way. It will not! We just have to remember his promise. All things work together for good to them that love God. Because God finds a way to give himself glory and to work it out for your good. And some of us might be better off dead. That's just the truth, you know, brethren. I'm finished. Because he wants to get glory, he says, I'm so sorry. I'm sitting down. I need this to get worse. Because I need to get some big glory from your life, Lazarus. And if I come now, nothing new will be known about me. I've got to wait until the situation gets really terrible. Because I need for these disciples and for the folks around to see a dimension of me that they have never seen before. And the only way I can get glory from this, you already know that I can open blind eyes. You already know some of the stuff I can do. You already saw what I did with the daughter of Jairus. And some of you went away thinking, oh, she was just in a coma. Just like the widow of Nain's son. So now I'm going to prove to you what I can do. So now I have to wait until you are convinced that his body is starting to decay. I have to wait until the worms start to eat him. I have to wait until his eyeballs are removed from the socket and begin to melt. I have to wait until there's a stench coming from him. Listen. I've got to wait until the whole world has given up on her. I've got to wait until the church begins to gossip about him. I've got to wait until the pastor stops praying for him. Because I want glory. I don't want it, even anybody to say it was my prayer. I want the whole world to give up so that I can beat my chest and say, that's me now. That's me now. Take your little selves out of the way. Always we want to get our hands in God's glory. Always we want the light to shine on us. Always we want Jesus to step in the background. But there are some times when he says, no! No. I'm going to wait. See, I really believe that when the stone was rolled away, there was a terrible stench that came out. I believe that. Because what else would be the proof? When they smelled it, they knew. Death is here. Not just death, but corruption. There's decay here. There's a stench here. Nothing good can come of this. That's why he said, roll away the stone. Want to mash the whole concept up. Yes, I could have come earlier. But then, what would you know about me that you didn't know before? Let's start. You know, I want to challenge some men. I really want to challenge some men. Men, it's time for us to live our lives for the glory of God. I found that men need a challenge. Not every man. You know, there are some men that are uncomfortable about blowing kisses to Jesus. There are some men that are uncomfortable about talking about sweetie pie Jesus and honey bunch Jesus. There are some men that need a challenge. And I want to call the men of this church to live your life for the glory of God. I want to call upon some men in this church to be ready, if necessary, to give your life for Jesus. Not for the organization or for Pentecostal Tabernacle or for Pastor Bartlett, but for Jesus. Some men who will not compromise their principles. This is the way I do business. And if it means I won't make a profit, I'm not going to do it that other way. For the glory of God. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God. This situation is not unto death, but for the glory of God. We need to practice that. As anything untoward happens, we need, before we begin to fuss, let's say, God, show me how you will get glory out of this. I know you want to achieve something for yourself. You would not have put me here if you didn't want to pick yourself up. And worship Jesus. So when the stone is rolled away, and when I say, Lazarus, come forth, I want you to try this. Try it. You can't try it with yourself. You have to try it with somebody. I want you to, when you go home, maybe not today, because we have to go to service later. But I want you to get some bandages and bind somebody up from their feet right up to their head. I want you to do that and then see if they can walk out of a tomb. How in the name of heaven did Lazarus walk? Got out of the tomb by a miracle. And then Jesus says to the church, you take care of the smell now. You wash him down. You unwrap him. You loose him. There are some churches that will even try to loose them, but very few will let them go. Oh, every church wants to have control. Every church wants to say, I unwrapped you, so I will dictate where you go and what you do. But Jesus said, loose him and let him go. Let him go. Oh, I hear us sometimes jumping around them. Loose! Loose! Yeah, you think that's how we're going to get loose? I hope when they're loose, you will say, let him go! Praise God. Let him be what I have called him to be. Don't make him what you think he should be. Let him go. Let him go. Let him. I am the one who saved him. I just want you to unwrap him. When it was over, the Bible says the people, all of the people in Bethany said, now we believe on him. Now we believe on him. Now we believe on him. When the Pharisees saw it, they said, we have to kill him. And we have to kill Lazarus too. That's what they said.
Yes.
We have to kill back Lazarus. And we have to kill Jesus. This is too much glory. They said the whole world is gone out after him now. God, nobody ever did this before. The whole world is gone out after you. You want the whole world to go out after us? We need to get into some trouble. That's how the world will go after us. When we get into trouble and give God the glory, and when he brings us out, we honor him. That's how people will follow us. Think they'll follow us because we sing loud songs in church. On them with the Holy Ghost. They'll follow us. The whole world will go after us when they see a fragrance from our lives, when they smell a perfume. Put your hands and worship. I want to call some men to the altar. I don't know why I just want to call men. Just for 5 minutes. I want some men to come. And I want the men to come and say, I'm going to live my life for the glory of God. It's not about me anymore. It's about the glory of God. Whether I live or die, whether I'm rich or poor, whether I win or lose, my life is going to be lived for the glory of God. I am going to cause Jesus to pick himself up. I'm going to make sure I give him glory about him. Church has become so weak. How we just bellyache over everything. Everything must just work out the way we want it to work out. Or we cry. I don't mind crying. Cry, but when cry and still come to the party, man. Through your hurt and your pain, still give God the glory. Let him feel like you still are on his side. And the ladies want to join us. Live your life for the glory of God. Yes. Men at the altar, lift your hands and worship God. Man, I really need to see you later at that street service, you know. Giving God glory. Not just being on the sidelines, but being involved, praying with men, praying with women. Really giving God glory. This church needs to feel the impact of men who are committed to Jesus Christ, sold out. Men who love God above everything else. Men who are willing to die for the cause of Jesus Christ.
Oh, I live for Him who died for me. Oh, happy then my life shall be. I'll live for Him who died for me, my Savior and my God.
I live for Him.
I live for Him.
You know, men, we just need to get our act together. We just need to get our act together. We just need to start practicing saying no. When temptation comes to do what is not right, we need to just be able to say no. Just say no. I'm telling you, it works. Just say no. Immediately, just say no. This church needs to feel the impact of righteous men. We need to walk out on the devil. We need to say, I'm not going back to you after today. Yes, some man at the altar or in the building needs to say, no more adultery for me. No more fornication. No more abuse of my wife and my children. No more staying in the background. No more prayerlessness. No more lack of Bible reading. No more inactivity. No more backdoor deals. No more backdoor deals. I live for Him.
I live for Him. Who died for me. How happy then my life shall be. I live for Him.
Look around, men, and I want us to pray. If there's any man near to you that hasn't had an experience with Jesus, I want you to begin to pray with that man now, and the Lord will fill them with the Holy Ghost. If there's any lady in the building, you've never had an experience with Jesus, or maybe you have had an experience, but you have walked away from the Lord. I want to invite you to this altar. Come, let's pray for you. You can give the Lord 10 minutes more of your time. I want to invite you to come to this altar. Don't be afraid. We just want to pray with you. And I tell you the truth, brethren. I'm getting so suspicious of purely emotional responses. I'm just wondering sometimes if we need to be more conscious of the decisions we're making. Make decisions having thought them through. This is what I want to do. Not just, I just feel high right now. But a conscious decision. Maybe not even feeling very much. Not even speaking in tongues. Not feeling any anointing. But just knowing in your heart that this is right. And saying, I'm going to do what's right. I might not speak in tongues, but I'm going to do what's right. I might not be feeling any anointing, but I'm going to do what's right. I might not shout hallelujah, but I'm going to do what's right. Walk away from this altar with purpose burning in my heart. To do what's right. To go home and fix it. Make a commitment to Jesus. I'm going to fix it. Live my life for the glory of God. We can do it, men. God is calling us to a very high level of living. Very high. Very high level of living. And I'm not talking about rules now. I'm talking about obedience to his voice. Where he can ask you to give stuff up for his glory. Where he can lead you down paths that you have never been before for his glory. Where he can draw you aside and say, I don't want you to do this. It's okay for Fred to do it, but not for you. Where you can walk softly before him. Where he can give you a song in the night. Where he can wake you up the still hours of the morning and say, seek my face for half an hour. Then go back to bed. Wake up and study this. Put a scripture in your heart. Study this just for an hour. I'll make up your sleep. Let's lift our hands and worship God. Let's all stand, everybody in the building. We're going to pray. Men, just get together and hold hands. You know, there are some men in the altar that need the Holy Ghost. Some women too, just a few women here need the Holy Ghost. Hold hands, men. We're going to pray. Then we're going to go. For the glory of God. For the glory of God. That's why I'm here. That's why this has happened. For the glory of God. It didn't happen to destroy me. It didn't happen to break me down. It happened so that God can get glory from my life. Let them see how a Christian deals with adversity. Let me die with a song on my lips. Let me go out with a praise on my lips. Let me go through with a smile on my face. Let's talk to God on behalf of each other. Men, would you do that, please? Just pray intensely for each other. Everybody in the building, just hold hands with somebody else and pray with them. Pray for them. Yes. Deeply. 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 Come on, men. Come on. Some of you are broken. Some of you are troubled. Some of you are tossed. Some of you standing in water so deep your head is not rising above the tide. You're just learning how to swim. Talk to Jesus.